Welcome back for part two of our chapter that's going to be focusing on classroom management. So where we left off, we were going to start to look at philosophies or theories behind classroom management. Now we're only going to be focusing on three. I'm sure there's more than that, but let's start with the idea of behavior modification. This theory goes back to the behaviorists, such as B.F. Skinner and operant conditioning, the idea that student behavior is learned, and you can modify or adapt or change that behavior by using things like reinforcement and punishment. If you've already had an intro psychology course, you would have already gone over concepts like this. Here's a short video. This video cracks me up. So it's the application of behaviorist principles for teaching cats. Okay, I could watch that all day. So basically, the cats have learned if they ring the bell, they get a treat or they get a reward. So behavior modification is the same kind of idea. If you reward certain behaviors, they will increase. If you punish certain behaviors, they will decrease. There are all kinds of rewards you can use in the classroom, whether you're looking at a treasure box, whether you're looking at certificates, whether you're doing buttons or brag tags or little rewards like they get crazy hair day or they get to the front of the line. Then there's also the other side, which is punishments. So if you're doing some sort of a token economy in your class, you could have both rewards and punishments built into one system. Or you could look at other kinds of consequences. But behavior modification is all about the idea of trying to change behavior by applying these two things, rewards and punishments. Our second big theory, shall we say, when it comes to classroom management is called assertive discipline. So this is managing behavior by using a set of increasing consequences. And usually what teachers do for this is some sort of a color coding system. The picture I have on the side is what we call a stoplight system. So all the students start the day on green. If their behavior starts to get out of line, they might move their clothespin that has their name on it to yellow, indicating a warning that they need to consider changing their behavior. And if their behavior continues to be poor, then they could get moved up to red where they would have a consequence. And you can see at the top of that picture that it explains what the different consequences are. Here are some other ways that you can do that. So you could also have this system down below where each student has their own individual colored card that you could flip. You can see the one at the far left has more levels than just the red, yellow, and green. So there are a variety of ways you can do it. Our last one is a large group called social, emotional, and group dynamics. Now for your textbook, it discussed a lot of different separate theories under this umbrella. I'm gonna just simply go through what they have in common rather than giving you all of their names. So for this group of theories, when it comes to classroom management, one of the things that they're about is having respect for the rights of your students, almost seeing them as citizens in your classroom. I found this picture down below where you can see they created a classroom bill of rights, and that idea really fits with this idea for classroom management. Now here is a parody showing kind of the opposite of that. So this is from, oh gosh, I forget the name of the movie, but you'll see an example of a teacher who certainly is not at all respecting the rights of his students.
Well, Farley, it looks like you forgot your gym clothes again.
No, sir. Somebody brought
it. It's a rhetorical question, Farley.
What?
Gutierrez, go get the rentals. Start changing. No, in line.
What?
See, the locker room is reserved for people who brought the appropriate attire. You change here.
It's okay, sir.
No talking, Netterman. 10 laps. Take Wheezy with you. Come on, let's go. Rentals, Farley, is 25 cents.
But somebody stole
I didn't ask you a question, Farley, not even a rhetorical one.
But
it seems to me that someone needs a lesson in personal responsibility. Not even one chin up, Farley.
Can't hang on.
You are a disgrace to fat, gelatinous, out-of-shape little kids the world over. I don't tolerate losers in my gymnasium. Are you going to be a loser?
Now, obviously, that movie came from a comedy. And although, yes, on one hand it is considered funny, on the other hand it is also quite distressing to think of a teacher that could teach their students that way. And obviously not at all respecting the rights or feelings of their students. I think sometimes we can learn as much from a parody and a bad example as we can from a good one. All right, continuing with this group of theories, they focus on the idea of students being members of a classroom community. And if you're a member of a classroom community, you're more likely to want to work together and not want to rock the boat. So I love this example over here, the idea of a class pledge, where the students are all pledging to work together and do their best. Also, within this type of class, you're going to want to give your students opportunities to be leaders. Whether that means line leader, whether that means letting them be in charge of a group, letting them make a decision on what book you're going to read, give them choices and opportunities to practice leadership. Here's a short video that gets at that point as well.
Hey, hey, ho, ha, what is that?
What's what?
What are you playing?
It's just something I wrote.
You wrote a song? Well, let's hear it.
Nah, it's not that good.
Come on, I want to hear it, Kurt Cobain.
Okay, but I'm not much of a singer.
It's all right.
Maybe we were making straight A's, but we were stuck in the dumb days. Don't take much to memorize your lies. Feel like I've been hypnotized.
Wait, you wrote that? You wrote that. Okay, that's it. You guys, rock and roll positions.
What are you doing?
What am I doing? We're gonna learn your song. What was that first chord?
D.
Play it.
D. Mm-hmm. D. Mm-hmm. D. Mm-hmm. Maybe we were making straight A's.
Yeah, yeah.
But we were stuck in the dumb days.
Mm-hmm.
Don't take much to memorize your lies. And if you wanna be the teacher,
so the point of this video is he really let the students shine and have a leadership position rather than him always being the one teaching the songs and being the music expert. He noticed the students' talent and let him lead the class. And that can make a huge difference when it comes to classroom management. And moving on, another one within the same idea. Help students to take responsibility for their own actions. Talk with them about the importance of making good choices. So when it comes to misbehaviors, those things are a choice, and teaching them that student choice is about owning their learning process and being responsible for their own behaviors. Let's look at some other issues or things that you can do that relate to having a well-managed classroom. Now, this first one sounds kind of simple, but it's actually quite helpful, and that is room arrangement. Where are you going to put your chairs, your tables, your bookshelves, your activities? You want to make sure that your students can clearly see where instruction is taking place and you can clearly see your students. When you're dealing with room arrangement, you also want to think about how you can minimize distractions. So you may not want the students sitting too close to one another. You may want to have the option to move students around. So if you have an especially talkative student, it's actually helpful if they're sitting right up front, close to the teacher. Although, you will have some students who will talk wherever you put them, so that's a whole other issue. You want to think about what can you do in your room to make your students feel comfortable. Looking at how you decorate it, putting down a rug, changing the seating around can make a huge difference. So in the pictures below, the one on your left is a pretty typical college classroom. They are boring, they are bare, they are not cozy at all. Look at the elementary class on the right. I think we would all like to sit on that carpet and hear a story. So what can you do to make your students feel comfortable in your class? Also, paperwork. You're going to be dealing with a lot of paperwork every single day. Handing back papers, collecting papers, distributing work for them to do in class. You want to think ahead of time about some sort of a system for dealing with all that paperwork to have things run more smoothly. Another thing when we're talking about having things run smoothly is to think of your structure, your rules, procedures, and routines. So rules are what your students can and can't do. Procedures are how they get things done. What do they do if they need to sharpen their pencil? What do they do if they need to go to the bathroom? Your routines are things like, so what do they do when they walk into the classroom? What's the morning routine? What's the routine to get them to lunch? All these things create a set of structure and organization for your class. So here's a video from Kindergarten Cop. So we saw his first day where Arnold Schwarzenegger, and this was in part one, where his class just ran amok because he had no plan. Now you're going to see him trying to create some routines and procedures.
Now, the first thing the deputy trainees have to learn is to freeze whenever you hear this. Now, the next time you hear this whistle, each one of you get one toy. How many?
One!
Good, and bring it back to the carpet. Pronto. Ready? Wait for it! Wait for it. Sit down. Ready? Go quickly. Get your toy. Go. Go for it. Yes, very fast. Good. Quickly. Bring the toy back. Bring the toy back to the carpet. Bring it back to the... Very good. Did very well. Now we're going to play another game. When you hear two whistle blows, each one of you take your toy back where you got it from and come right back to the carpet. How many whistle blows?
Two!
Good. Ready? Go! Come on. Come right back to the carpet. It works. This is great. Faster, faster. Come on. Yes, come back. Terrific. This is working. Great, great. I'm in. Very good deputies.
So you can see little things that create structure and routine can be extremely helpful. I love this quote, routines are the backbone of daily classroom life. They facilitate teaching and learning. They don't just make your life easier, they save valuable classroom time. And they make it easier for students to learn and achieve. So there are lots of routines and procedures you're going to want to think about. What do they do when they come in the morning? What do you want to do to get them to be quiet and pay attention? How do they line up to go down the hallway? Another characteristic of a well-managed class is that the students are engaged. They are productive. They are involved in work. So they are in the process of learning. They're not just wasting time. They're not chit-chatting to one another. They are doing the work of academic learning. And this work is purposeful, that you're not just giving them busy work that has no meaning, that the work is geared towards your learning outcomes, is purposeful. Another really important one is time management. In the classroom, we also sometimes call this time on task, the idea of how much time during the day is actually spent learning, and perhaps how much of it is being wasted. You know, so how much time is wasted because the instructor isn't prepared and they're at their desk shuffling through papers? Or how much time is wasted because the lesson was too short and now you have 10 minutes to kill? So is your time being used wisely? All right, so where we're going to end today is by looking at handling misbehaviors. We're not going to get too specific because this is just an intro course, but just to give you an idea of some of the thought behind handling misbehaviors. So you can see from this chart I made, there are two approaches. The discipline approach is talking about when there's a misbehavior, you punish it. You can see at the bottom, it provides only temporary compliance. It is not really something that causes lifelong learning in your students. On the left is the approach we'll be focusing on, the classroom management approach. Thinking proactively, focusing on keeping your students productive and helping them learn some responsibility. And I love this quote too, discipline in the 21st century should be proactive, focused on preventing conflicts and disruptions, not just punishing behavior, misbehaviors. The goal should be self-control. The teacher's job is not to control, but to teach, not to command, but to influence. So how do we do that? Well, when we're talking about misbehaviors, when you're dealing with a misbehavior, the term we use for that is an intervention. That term can be used in different ways, but for this particular part of teaching, we're talking about dealing with misbehavior. So an intervention is the teacher's behavior that is aimed at either getting rid of a misbehavior or increasing a desired behavior. Okay, so regardless, you're trying to improve good behavior in your classroom. Interventions all have three different goals. One, the point should be to stop that misbehavior, to stop it quickly and easily and simply. Okay, the simplest way possible. But number two, to maintain your flow of instruction. You don't want to disrupt learning. You don't want to stop everything in your lesson and halt it to deal with this misbehavior. So trying to deal with the misbehavior quickly while also continuing with your lesson and help the students learn from the experience, that everybody learns something so that the class continues moving forward on a better path. So I have a video example. This is, again, one of my bad examples. So in this example, and it's from a very famous teaching movie, Stand and Deliver, where the teacher is considered quite famed and to be a good teacher. But I think in this example, he does everything wrong. So the student came in late. A late student is the misbehavior.
The counselor was just here looking for you. Something about some cosmetology classes. He says there's three different levels. One for boys, one for girls, and one for I don't know what kind. Why don't you go find out?
Okay, well, please listen, man. It's cool. My grandmother.
Clock out. Game's over. You lose.
You never listen to nobody, man. The grizzle must be gone.
Adios. Why don't you send me some postcards or call me on the telephone. Let me know how you're doing. We love you.
Kill somebody, this cabrón, huh?
Mind you, I think that guy's got a bigger problem than you. Tick, tack, toe. Simple.
Okay, in that example, let's go back to our previous slide. I'm going to pull it up here. First of all, did he stop the misbehavior quickly? Did he handle it easily? No, he drug it on. And in doing so, he also insulted the student and insulted another student. Did he maintain the flow of the lesson? Not really. I mean, yes, he continued solving the problem on the board, but no one was paying attention to that. No one learned from that. And then down below, help students learn from the experience. I'm not sure that they learned anything other than the fact that their teacher can be pretty callous and mean. So, bad example for handling a misbehavior. In terms of tips for handling a misbehavior, focus first on prevention. I think that is key. So, don't wait for the misbehavior to happen. Think ahead of time, what are some common misbehaviors? What can I do to prevent them before they ever come about? Some little things, make sure it's in your class rules. Go over your class rules, remind your students of the rules. Use little things like down below here, we have a noise level barometer to let your students know how loud they should be. Keep reminding them of what you expect to see in them. Another one, be observant and aware. You want your students to think like the cartoon down below, that even when perhaps your back is turned, you still know what's going on. So you don't want to be like John Lovitz in the video below. You want to make sure that your students feel like and know that you know what's going on, that you're watching, that you're observant. Thirdly, you want to keep calm. You don't want to get upset. You want to keep your emotions under control, and you want to think about your students' emotions as well. So that previous video from Stand and Deliver, he certainly wasn't considering that as well. He probably triggered a lot of students in that class with his little outburst with the student who came in late. So some examples of this, some poor examples from movies, whether you're thinking about Harry Potter or Matilda, there are a lot of examples out there of teachers who don't really think about their students' emotions and don't worry about being calm, and they should. be consistent. So when it comes to following through with your rules, you want to make sure that you always follow through, that you're not using empty threats when it comes to your rules, and that you treat each student consistently. So the first cell phone infraction gets the same response as the second one and the third one and the fourth one. And you want to consider doing something that we call using logical consequences. Logical consequences are great if you want your students to learn something from the punishment. So you can see my example here on the side. So the idea of if they have incomplete work, that they need to stay in at recess and finish it. That if they are talking during instruction, that they get separated from the group. That if they're wasting instructional time, they have to make it up at recess, and so on. That is it. Now, you will in the future take lots of courses and spend more time on classroom management, but I thought that was a good introduction to give you a feel for it. So thank you for your attention, and I'll see you next time.